Okay, so good morning. I think we have around 18 participants. So wait for some more time so that few more people or students can join. In the meantime, there is a announcement for you all. Those of you who have completed the model for combined ISC, the vehicle model for combined ISC, you are requested to share the photos of that model with me on my WhatsApp. If you have not yet completed the model, for those teams or students who are belonging to the teams who have not yet completed the vehicle model, or let us say the body in white, which you are going to test. So those students, we are going to devise another method of ISC. Okay. So I have already received photos of a model from one student, and nobody else has already shared what you have made. So all of you are instructed that if you have already completed the welding and fabrication of those models, you need to share that with me. Okay. Now we have around 26 participants. So I guess we can start now with our presentation. Otherwise, because of time limit, we will not be able to cover much part. So we'll start where we left off in the previous lecture that we had. So I hope all of you are able to see my presentation now. In case there are any doubts, you can
ask.
You can raise your doubts in the chat section, or you can even raise your hand if you want to ask me any doubt. Okay. So right now, I believe all of you are mute. Okay. If you want to ask a doubt, just unmute yourself and you can then ask any doubt that you have in between while we are going through the points. Right. So the last point that we had covered in the lecture, it was on the aspects of ergonomics for driver's seat and cabin design. So the last thing that I had asked you to note down was these five points, which are the driver's seat and cabin design. So I saw somebody asking a doubt. Okay. So I guess he has deleted that message. Anyways, so the five aspects of ergonomic for driver seat and cabin design, they are safety, comfort, ease of use, and productivity or performance of the driver, as well as the aesthetics that you're going to be taking care of. So obviously you want your vehicle to be designed in such a way that it is safe for the occupants as well as the driver. That is the reason why the first aspect comes into picture, which is safety. After that, the comfort is quite important in case of an automobile, because in many of the cases, people are going to buy the automobile taking into consideration what is the comfort level inside the vehicle, right? So as they might use it for long distance driving, or in some cases, you'll be having customers who are going to be quite wealthy. So what they look for in a vehicle is that what is the comfort that is provided. So if you compare regular passenger cars with high-end, let us say, luxury cars, you might find that in case of luxury cars, there is quite a lot of amount of comfort that is being provided to the customer. So the leg space or leg room that they have, or you might have another sort of comfort, so wherein you can heat your seats, or you can even have a massage when you're going to sit on the seats. Then in some very high-end luxury cars, you'll also find that there are provisions to store umbrellas in the door, right? Or you also have, let us say, screens which are mounted on the rear end of the driver seat or the co-driver seat, so that the passengers who are sitting on the second row, they can have to watch videos when they're traveling. Okay, so next is ease of use. So the driver's seat or the cabin has to be designed in such a way that whatever controls are being provided on the particular dashboard, so those are easy for the driver to use. So I hope you remember that we have seen a video in the last or last before the last lecture, and in that you have seen a Volvo truck cabin, right? So you had seen that how they had designed the cabin in such a way that the driver can easily operate all the controls and also change his sitting position, or let us say the steering wheel position, as well as he can access all the controls from the seating on which he's going to be seated. Okay, so without the help of any, let us say, co-driver or a helper, even a single person who is driving that truck, he can easily manage all the things, right? And apart from that, if you check the comfort again for that particular cabin, you will find that they had a provision for the driver to sleep whenever he is going to be traveling for long distances. Okay, so Kunal has asked me one point about alternate ISE. So those of you, again, I'll repeat because I see number of people joining in now, around 35. I'm also going to discuss this at the end. But those people who have not yet prepared the model for combined ISE, model of the vehicle, okay, which we had assigned to you, for them, there might be an alternate ISE, because now we don't know when you'll be coming back. Okay, so only one group has shared photos of that particular model, a bus model. So at the end of this lecture, again, we'll discuss about this. We'll just continue with the points right now. In the last 5 minutes, we'll discuss about what is the alternate ISE that we might have. Okay, fine. So going ahead, different aspects of driver's cabin. You have got occupant packaging, which has to be taken care of. The CAD or CAE ergonomic design. Okay, so using softwares or different commercial packages which are available, you can even design the driver's cab inside that particular software and find out what are the reaches of different controls that you have and what is the comfort that you're going to have in that case. Okay, so going ahead, the visual aspects that you have inside your driver cabin is also very important. How the driver is able to spot, let us say, different objects that are on the road, and as well as what are the oncoming traffic, and even what is the traffic behind that particular driver, right? Then you have got seat design. So seat design inside a driver's cabin is also an important part. So again, I am going to refer the video that we saw. So therein you saw that how the driver's seat was designed in such a way that it was of utmost comfort to that particular driver, as well as he can change the sitting height, sitting position. Okay, edge point location can be changed. He can even heat up the seat in countries wherein you have got very cold weather. So therein, the manufacturers or OEMs, they try and provide an inbuilt heater on the seat. Okay, so instead of having, let us say, obviously air conditioning will be there, but apart from that, if you have a seat which is heated, it is going to, let us say, give more comfort to the driver. Okay, and many other things which have been designed in such a way that the seat is going to be adding comfort for the driver. Right, you've got some other aspects in automobile design. So now from the cabin design, we have moved to automobile design. So overall, if you are looking at the automobile, the first one again is going to be visual aspect, already discussed. Then there can also be airbag warnings inside your vehicle, right? So if you are not using your seat belt, so in that case, there might be a warning. In case the airbags, generally they're going to work at, or in case of an accident. But then if you're not wearing a seat belt, in that case, only airbag might not be able to provide you sufficient amount of protection in case of a crash. Then comfort, usability of seat belts. You've got collision avoidance systems. So in some of the vehicles, you also have something known as a collision avoidance system. Okay, so this is something which was developed by high-end OEMs, or let us say OEMs like Mercedes-Benz or even BMW. But right now you don't find that in many of the regular passenger cars that you have on the road. Okay, but the system is such a way that in case it detects any object, okay, or obstruction on the road, it is going to automatically apply brakes. Okay, so it will avoid any collision with any object that you have in front. If the driver is not alert, and if the avoidance system, collision avoidance system, finds that there is going to be a collision or a crash, it is going to automatically apply brake and avoid that collision. Okay, so this particular system is very commonly used in Indian railways. So on the railways now, you'll find that this system is quite common because they want to avoid crashing of railways with another railways. Okay, so to avoid those accidents, this system has been deployed there. So Indian Railways use this collision avoidance system. Then you've got traction control system. You already know about this. Just to brief in short about it. So how is the traction at each tire road contact patch? What are the normal reactions or weights on each of the tires? And depending upon that, it will decide what is the amount of tractive force which can be supplied to that particular tire. Okay. So traction control system generally works very good if you have got an all-wheel drive. Even if it is not there, in case of, let us say, a rear or front wheel drive also, you can deploy a traction control system on the vehicle that you have. Okay. Then brake assist system, a system which is going to help, let us say, the driver to apply the brakes. Okay. In some cases, you also have a brake assist system which is going to identify if the driver is going for a panic braking. Okay. So if the brake assist system understands that the driver is trying to suddenly press or apply force on your brake pedal, so what happens in that case? It is going to make sure that along with the brake assist system, ABS is also going to be there. So it is going to make sure that there is no wheel lockup, because again, because of the, or due to the wheel lockup, the vehicle can go into sliding condition. So let us say your rear wheels, they are going to be locked up during panic braking, so the vehicle can move sideways. Okay, and in case of the front wheels getting locked up whenever you have got a panic braking situation, or let us say a lot of brake force which is being applied, so you can lose the steering control or steerability of the vehicle is going to be affected. Okay, going ahead, you can also have navigation system. Nowadays quite common in even the basic cars. So because you also have an infotainment system on your dashboard, so along with that, many OEMs now provide a built-in GPS navigation system. So it can help you navigate through areas which are new to you or you are not aware about, and hence instead of using your mobiles to find out or using Google Maps on your mobiles for navigation, you can have an inbuilt GPS system inside the vehicle. Right, next you have got the vehicle interiors, controls and pedals. So you need to take care of all these things for having the best possible design and comfort for your customers. Another important point is the reach that you have for advanced recreational systems that you're going to use inside the vehicle. Okay, so what generally happens in case of vehicles which are having a lot of different types of recreational systems is that in some of the cases you will find that the driver is going to be, let us say, applying your or using your recreational systems while he's driving. Okay, so in that case, what might happen is that because he's trying to use or switch on these recreational systems, he might lose his attention on the road. Okay, and once that happens, it is going to lead to accidents. So you need to make sure that whatever different types of recreational systems are provided inside your vehicle, those are easily accessible. And if the driver is going to operate those different types of systems, he should not go into a condition wherein it is going to affect his safety. Okay. So I hope I have covered all the points here. If at all there are any doubts, I'm going to take a small pause. We have covered two or three different slides. So if you have any doubts till now, you are free to ask me right now. Okay. You can either unmute yourself and ask me directly using your audio, or you can ask me in chat. What about wipers? Does it come under Aditya is asking me a doubt. What about wipers and does it come under it? Ergonomic aspect, wipers are not going to majorly affect, but even then, they might come under the visual aspect that you're going to have. Okay. So that is the reason why when the first wipers were designed and developed, okay, what used to happen is that those wipers, they used to continuously rotate. Okay. So because of that, if they continuously keep on cleaning your screen, what generally used to happen is that the visibility of the driver used to be affected, okay, because it's a disturbance. So whenever the wipers are, let us say, continuously being operated, it might lead to disturbance and the visibility that the driver has, okay, may be affected. So then what was done in that case is that after that, a specific patent was filed by one person or a designer who found out that if we can have the wipers which are going to be stationary for some time, okay, so if you see the current wipers, after one specific round of your cleaning or wiping the let us say windscreen, they will generally have a small pause, okay, so that pause is given so that there is some visibility for the driver, okay, so generally that is the reason why this particular type of system was designed. Okay, so those are going to affect whatever visibility that you have, right? So I hope I have cleared your doubt. So we'll go ahead. Okay, I think there is one more doubt. Okay, so he has understood that. Okay, we'll go ahead now. The next part is something known as occupant packaging. Okay, so this is again very important because whenever you design a driver's cabin, or let us say driver and co-driver, they're going to be sitting together to their cabin, you need to make sure that whatever size of your driver and co-driver are going to be seated inside, they need to be comfortable. Okay, so this particular term is known as occupant packaging. So for this, again, you are going to require different dimensions. So all these dimensions are covered up under anthropometry. So this is also known as workspace anthropometry, but this was generally started in the industrial engineering let us say domain, and the main concern in this particular workspace anthropometry was that how does the operator reacts or interacts with the workstation on which he's going to work. But then later on, this particular data that was taken up or measured by different agencies was also used for designing your automobiles. Okay, so we have already seen this in our class, but there are a few more diagrams now which I'm going to show as we go ahead. So therein, all the different dimensions for a huge diversity of population are measured, and these measurements are noted. So let us say, what is the length of from your elbow to your fingers? What is the length from your shoulders to your fingers? Then what is the length from your hips to knee joint? From your knee joint to your foot, okay, and then from the ankle to your fingers of your foot. So again, when you are seated, when the occupant is going to be sitting, so what are the different dimensions? What is the edge point? So edge point is something which is very important, right? So I think some of you might have studied that if you have designed your own vehicles for different teams that we have. So all these dimensions, they are generally recorded and noted. And now they are also open for the general public to use. Okay, so if you try and find out, you will get that these dimensions for US, so different population that you have in US, they are freely available to all the people throughout the world. Okay, so these are sometimes, mostly these are static measurements. So these measurements are going to be used by and or measured by an anthropologist. Okay, and they are taken on a human body which is rigid and in standardized position. Okay. So in static conditions, let us say when the person is standing, okay, then after that, if the person is reaching out to some object, so what is the reach? So the person whose measurements are being taken, they might be with his hands opened out. Okay. Yeah, we are going to discuss that. So Dheeraj is asking, what are the different types of measurements that we take in anthropology? So we are going to discuss that very soon. In the next slide, you will see all the different types of measurements. Okay, so we're going to go there. Okay, so then next is is something known as functional task-oriented measurement. So an engineer or a designer is going to require this particular type of, let us say, measurement. Okay. So these measurements are taken when the person or an operator is going to work in some workspace. Okay. So we'll just see what are these different dimensions. Yeah. So the first or the previous doubt that was raised by Dheeraj, I hope this is going to be helpful for understanding that. So whenever you have got occupant packaging, what is going to happen is that you are going to try and sit or seat that particular, let us say, person on your vehicle seat. And then you can see that there are two different models right now in this particular slide. Okay, so the smaller model is 5 percentile female. I have already discussed this with you earlier. What is the 5 percentile female and 95 percentile male? So if you remember, in the first module, when we discussed about dummies which are used for crash testing. So there we have discussed what dimensions are taken for a 5th percentile female model, dummy model, and 95th percentile male dummy model. Okay. So these two occupants that you see, these are models for 5th percentile female and 95th percentile male. So the reason why this particular range is chosen is because in this particular range, although entire population might not be covered, but almost 99% or more than 95% of the population that you have is covered. Okay. So again, this data is going to vary from region to region, from continent to continent. So for India, it may be different. For Japan, it may be different. In US, you might have different data for 5th percentile female and 95th percentile male. Again, in Africa, these dimensions might be larger as compared to what we have here in India or let us say Japan. So Japan, you will find generally that the overall dimensions for the general public in Japan is quite short as compared to what we have here in India. Okay. And if you try again to compare this with African population, it might be more than as compared to what we have in India. Right. So depending upon what is the body structure of the people who are living in that region, these dimensions are going to change. Okay. And that is the reason why country to country also, you need to have a different design of your vehicle. Okay, so you can see that this is, I think I need to correct myself, it is not 5th percentile female and 95th percentile male. It is from 1 percentile small woman to 99 percentile large man. Okay, so more, again, more than what I just discussed is being covered under this. Okay, so these dimensions are given here in inches as well as in mm. So you can see that for a 99 percentile US large man, his stature is about 1920 mm. Okay, then the weight is 111.2 kg. Okay, the slump, whenever he's going to sit, the slump is around 25 mm. The abdomen dimensions are 349 mm. For a female, small 1 percentile female model, you will see that the height is 1476 mm, and the weight is 30.5 kg. Slump is 0. Okay, so all these different dimensions are checked out. You can see here that even what is the amount of pedal travel that can happen. So if you've got an accelerator or brake pedal at this particular location, so there it has also been mentioned that what is the maximum amount of travel that that particular person can do is also shown here. Okay, so you can see that ankle angle, then what is the pedal foot press that can be done in degrees. It has been calculated. Okay. After that, you'll see that even what is the vision of that particular person, even that is calculated. So the diagrams that you see over here. Okay. So these are generally considered to even define what is going to be the total height of your traffic lights. Okay. So depending upon, see, that particular point is shown over here. To see traffic signals, the vehicle has to be designed in such a way that from the horizontal side that the driver is going to have, there is at least a 15 degree vision field upwards. Okay. So in the seated condition, if you don't try and allow this particular vision, 15 degree open vision, the driver will not be able to spot the traffic signals. And conversely, the traffic signals are designed in such a way that the height of your signals, they are designed in such a way that for any vehicle, they are easily spottable. Okay. So the same thing is done for a female, let us say, model. And that is the reason, or that is the way in which you need to design. So again, after that, you will also see that there is a preferable adjustable distance that you have for even your steering, right? So I'll just clear all this so that all of you are able to clearly see all the different dimensions. Okay. So then again, at the edge point is something that I have discussed quite a number of times. So I'm going to locate that particular edge point. So it is located at this particular location. Generally, the hip that you have. Okay. So that is the place where edge point is going to be located. And from this edge point, all the dimensions are generally taken. So from the edge point or hip point, you can even take it till the knee. That is the overall, let us say, seat length that you want to have, or slightly less than this total length. Then from the knee to the ankle, and from the ankle to the fingers or fingertip of your foot. Okay. So some more doubts. Pointer visible. Okay. If pointer is not visible, what I'm doing is I'm drawing, let us say, it on the screen, but I will also try and draw it using a pen also. Okay. So the dimensions that I'm talking about is from this edge point to this knee joint. Okay. So this dimension, then again, from this knee joint to the ankle. Okay. So this is the ankle. So over here, and again from the ankle to the tip of your fingertip of your feet. Okay. So these are the dimensions that I just now discussed. Apart from this, you also need to find out from the edge point again, let us say, what is the dimension till your neck. Okay. Because this is the seat rest that you're going to provide for the driver. And again, from this particular point that you have, which is the neck, to the top. And you also need to make sure that there is some clearance. Okay. So whenever somebody is going to be sitting, so that clearance is shown here. Okay. So all these considerations need to be taken. So it is not a very easy job to fit your occupant inside the driver cabin that you have. Okay. Now we have just talked about the locations or dimensions that need to be taken care whenever you are going to have the fitment. Okay. Another dimension is this particular dimension from your hand or fingertips till your joint over here. Okay. Now this is because this is going to define in a comfortable position what is the reach. Okay. So whenever he's going to drive, wheel dimensions are diameter of, so, or are those wheel dimensions? Ritvik is asking a question. Wheel dimensions are of diameter or radius. So I don't see any wheel dimensions here right now. Okay, Ritvik, if you can show that on the screen as a participant, you are also okay. Wheel diameters, race car, sports car, auto. Yeah. So correct. Okay, I understood. So those are in diameters, I guess. Oh, that's a wheel diameter, right? That has been written there. So wheel diameters of whatever wheels that you have. So for race car, it is generally 10 to 12 inch diameter for the wheel that is used. In case of let us say sports car, 12 to 14 inch diameters of wheel are used. Okay. So is that doubt cleared, or still there is something that you need to ask? Okay. So I hope I am clear about that. If you want, again, you can even check out these or take a screenshot of this and check all these dimensions later. Right. So that might help you go through all these dimensions. But sir, notation is given in radius. Which notation? Notation for the wheel diameter in radius at what location has been given to you? Again, you can annotate on the screen, like you have drawn a circle about the wheel diameters. You can annotate here also. But even then, okay, I understand the doubt, but right now we are going to be running short of time. We only have around 3 minutes. So what right now you need to understand is that we are talking more about the occupant packaging. Okay, so we are not right now concerned about the wheel diameters right now. So that is a point maybe we can discuss in discussion forum. So more concern right now is how do you have the passenger comfortable? Okay, so then something known as thoracic support that you have. So above the seat shoulder, or let us say back rest that you have, you're also going to provide a thoracic support for the drivers to rest their head. Okay, driver and co-driver to rest their head. So again, any other dimension, right, that you see here which has not been discussed, you can ask me right now. So we are going to stop here today. This is the last slide today and we'll continue tomorrow. But the wheel radius or diameter that Ritvik is asking about, what you can do is you can ask me on WhatsApp or in discussion forum. So there we'll discuss. Okay. Yeah. So there is one arrow that has been drawn by somebody. So you can ask me a question. You can unmute yourself now. So all of you who wants to ask a question, unmute yourself and ask directly, orally. No need to type it in chat. So I don't hear anybody asking any questions. Okay, so apart from that, again, the different adjustments that are given to you. So here you can see that horizontal seat adjustment is given. So if there is a short person who is going to be sitting, so from this particular dimension, you can see that the edge point for one percentile female and edge point for 99th percentile male. So there is a long gap. Okay. So generally, this is the reason why you'll be provided with seat adjustment in horizontal direction on your vehicle. I have muted. Okay, fine. So let me unmute you. I have permitted you all to unmute it yourself. Okay, so I'm not going to unmute everybody when I muted you. So right now you have permission to unmute yourself. Okay. So anybody wants to ask a doubt, orally unmute yourself and then you can ask. So yeah. So if you are unmuted, Aditya Mane, if you are now unmuted yourself, you can talk and I'll be able to hear you. But what you need to do is make sure that you're using your headphones or your microphone. Is the measurement in mm? These measurements are in inches. Okay. All the measurements that you see here, they are in inches, and below that you find that in mm also the same thing has been given. So I'll just give an example. So if you see here, this is an inch and this is an mm. If you see here, this is an inch, 47.5 inch, this is 1210 mm. So both inches, or let us say both in MKS and SI unit, these dimensions have been given to you. Less than 1 minute remaining, so the measurement is going to be. Again, those of you who have not yet completed your model, fabrication of the model, we are thinking about giving you an alternate ISE, because we might not be able to conduct this ISE. We are going to be thinking about